Muhammad came to visit. What do I say? I say, Ja'a Muhammad li ziyar. Muhammad came for visit. That's it. This is if the audience or the listener doesn't have any doubt. That's the normal one. If the audience, the listener, has a doubt, then it changes. How does it change? It changes to add something we call in Arabic, adat tawkid. You have to put emphasis. What is it? In Arabic, it's a inna. Right? So that the listener knows that what you're saying is truth. And that inna, what it does, is to eliminate the doubt in his mind or her mind. Right? That is number two. Now, this is if the doubt is low. If the doubt is so deep, for example, it's 50% doubt. All right? Now, what happened? Then the adati toki, the emphasis becomes two. But two emphasis. So that the listener understand that whatever you're saying, there is no room for doubt. Good. If the doubt is 75%, what do you do? Allahu Akbar. Now here, you can add three, right? But if the doubt is 100%, then you go to completely different level. What is it? You start with swearing by the name of Allah. Mm-hmm. Now, in Arabic, if somebody or something, if I'm talking to you, and then I say, Wallah, without going in now, and that means I'm not eloquent in my speak in Arabic language. Because there's a pardon, right? Because the audience is not doubtful, so I have to start with normal. If the doubt is there, then I start with inna. If the doubt is higher, then I add two. For example, inna la. For example, inna zayd la ja'a. That la is called alpha tawkid too. If the doubt is much higher, then I say, wallahi, inna zayd la ja'a. Right? Mm. And this eliminates the entire doubt. Now, if this is clear, let's go to the ayah. The ayah started with what? Inna Allah, right? Inna Allah, which is the alpha tawkid, the emphasis. Why? Because Allah knows, not to the Prophet doesn't doubt, but Allah knows that around the Prophet there are people called munafiqun. Mm-hmm. That every ayah that comes, they have doubt that either the Prophet is the one who mixed it up or it's not from Allah. So to eliminate their doubt, Allah started with the ayah, Inna Allah. That's why in the ayah was Inna Allah. That Inna is to eliminate the doubt of the hypocrites around the Prophet. Good. That's the first one. The next one, then Allah said, Allah, Inna Allah. Allah is the most beautiful word you can ever say. You can ever see. This word, Allah, is called Lafdul Jalala. This Lafdul Jalala is amazing. Right? Now, just to make it easier for us, you know, Allah has 99 names. Al-Shakur, Al-Ghafur, Al-Rahim, Al-Wadud, Al-Basit, Al-Qabad, Al-Muhaymin, Al-Aziz, Al-Jabbar. All of these are the names of Allah. Right? And amazing, every one of those names, they represent something. Right? For example, I want Allah to forgive me. What do I call? Ya Ghafoor. Right? Allah is all forgiven. I want the mercy of Allah. What do I say? Ya Rahim. I want a knowledge from Allah. What do I call? Ya Aleem. I want people to love me. What do I call? Ya Wadood. Every one of them is there like what? Prescription. See, when you walk into the pharmacy, there is so many medicine inside the pharmacy, right? But you don't pick anyone because it's there. Even though they're all medicine, but you have to pick a medicine that is going to cure your disease or your sicknesses, right? The same thing also, the names of Allah, they are there as the spiritual medication. Allah. Whatever you need, you call upon Allah with that name to get what you need from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But on top of that, all of these 99 names that we have, there is one that is called Ismun Jami', The name that combines all the names one in one name. And that name is called Allah. Allahu Akbar. And that's one of the favorite names of Allah. And you know, out of the names of Allah that we're speaking about, Allah has chosen certain names, they are His favorite. He loves this name more than any other names. And you gotta know the tricks. Alright? So when you call upon Allah, you know which word to use for Allah to listen to you easily. And you go to Ahlul Bayt, they teach you those tricks. The first one is, Allah has a beautiful names that He loves more than the rest. One of them is the word Ar-Rahman. You go to the Quran, Allah says, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءِ الْحُسْنَى فَدْعُوهُ بِهَا أَيَّمَّا تَدْعُوا فَلَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. Allah said, I have so many names. You can call me with anyone that you want, right? But one of the chosen names that Allah loves is the word Ar-Rahman. And you go to the Quran, a lot of places Allah refers to Himself Ar-Rahman. In Surah Ar-Rahman, He said, Ar-Rahman Allama al-Quran. Another ayah says, Ar-Rahman ala al-arshis. He called Himself Ar-Rahman. That is one of the favorite names. And that is why these names, you cannot use it for anybody. Other names? Yes, you can. For example, Ash-Shakur. Can you call somebody Shakur? Yes, you can. But can you call somebody Ar-Rahman? No, you cannot. You can call someone Abdul Rahman, yes, but not Ar-Rahman. Because that word is meant for just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one of the favorite. Another favorite name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the Quran is the word Rabb. Rabb, yes, it's one of the favorite names of Allah. You go to the Quran, you see almost every prophet from the Quran, when they call Allah, they always call Him Rabb. Every prophet. And learn to know, when you call Him, you can say Allah, Ash-Shakur, Al-Ghafur, but one of the best names is Rabb. Now let me take you from the order. The first prophet, Prophet Adam alayhi salam. When Adam alayhi salam was sent out of the heaven, and he wants to call upon Allah, to ask Allah for forgiveness for him and his wife, look, what name did he call Allah? Rabbana zalamna anfusana. The word he calls Rabbana, the word Rabb. That is whom? That's Prophet Adam. Another prophet, the next prophet, Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, when he also wants to call Allah, in Surah Nuh, right? He called on Allah by the word Rabb. Look at the Surah Nuh, the last ayah. Rabbi ghafir li waliwalidayya walilmu'mineen waliman dakhala baytiya mu'minan. Right? And another ayah, Nuh alayhi salam also asked Allah, Rabbana rabbi ghafir li waliwalidayya walilmu'mineen. The word that he uses was the word Rabb. Now you go to Prophet Ibrahim, the same thing. Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he went to call Allah after he built the Kaaba and he finished, he said, Rabbi ja'alni muqim as-salat wa min dhurriyyati. Rabbana wa taqabbal du'a. The Prophet Ibrahim. Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam, the same thing. Where? In Quran, when Sulaiman saw the ant and he wanted to speak to Allah, after he was so amazed by the ant speaking to him, he said, Rabbi awzi'ni an ashkura ni'mataka allati an'amta alayhi. That's Prophet Sulaiman. His father, Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, when they went to the battle to fight Jalut, right? When he met Jalut and the other people were scared, and Prophet Dawood came forward to encourage them, he said, Rabbana afrigh alayna sabra wa thabbit aqdamana wansurna ala al-qawm al-kafirin. The word Rabb. Right? Now you come to another prophet also in Surah and Quran, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Prophet Isa alayhi salam. Right? When his people ask him to call upon Allah to send them the food from the heavens, and he wanted to ask Allah, he said, وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ اللَّهُمَّ رَبَّنَا أَنزِلْ عَلَيْنَا مَعِدَةً مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. The word Rabb is there. Our prophet, Allah is telling him, Ya Rasulullah, You want knowledge? Yes. I said, but when you want to call me with the white Arab. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي إِلْمًا. All the prophet across the board, when they want to call Allah, they call the what? Rabb. Now that is the prophet. Now our imams, how? Imam Ali alayhi salam in Dua Akumayr, he calls upon Allah in so many names. One of them, Ya Ilahi, Wa Sayyidi, Wa Mawla, Wa Malik Araqi. Right? All of these names. But none of them is repeated three times at once until he get to the word Ya Rabbi, Ya Rabbi, Ya Rabb, three times at the same time. Why Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? There's so many names of Allah, but none of them you repeated three times except the word Ya Rabb. Why? Because this word is one of the most favorite name of Allah. The same Imam Ali alayhi salam, when he was in his shahada, when he was in the masjid and he was struck, which name did he call? He said, first to Rabbil. Allah Akbar. Imam Ali, there's name of Allah. Why not? First to Allah, first to Al Ghafur, first to Al Shakur. He said, first to Rabbil Kaaba. Right? Not only that, you go to Hadith Al Kisa, when he asked the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, Malik Mali Julusina, Min Al Fadla Inda Allah, Tahta Al Kisa. And the Prophet told him, right? Ya Jibreel, Walladhi Ba'athani Bil Haqq Nabiya, right? واستفاني بالرسالة نجية ما ذكر خبرنا في محفل من محافل أهل الأرض وفيه جمع من شيعتنا ومحبينا إلا وحفت عليهم الملائكة واستغفرت لهم إلى أن يتفرقوا. Right? Now listen to the answer of Imam Ali. What do you say? إذا فزنا وفاز شيعتنا ورب الكعبة. In Hadith Al-Kisa. That is the word Rabb, but Imam Ali doesn't separate from the word Rabb, even in Hadith Al-Kisa. First two, Wafaza, Shi'atun, Wa Rabb Al-Ka'aba. Because the word Rabb is one of the most beautiful names. And this is some of the tricks of dua. Sometimes we make dua, we say, I don't hear any response from Allah. You gotta know the words to call upon Allah for Allah to listen to you. One of them is the word Rabb, right? That's one of the favorite of the names of Allah. But the word that Allah also loves the most is the word the Allah. That's one of the favorite names of Allah. And you see these favorite two words, Rabb and Allah, Allah combined them in one surah that we read on daily basis. Every single day, Allah said, when you stand in front of me, I want these two names. One that is Alhamdulillah. Lillah Rabbil Alameen. Allah and Rabb. Every single time we stand in front of Allah, we have to mention these two names. Because these are the most favorite names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only that. Now it says that the miracle of this name, Allah, right? Allah, those who know Arabic, how is it written? Aleph and Lam and Lam and Ha. Right? How many letters? Four letters. Aleph, Lam and Lam and Ha. Right? Now, these four letters, we call them Allah, right? Allah. If you take Alif out of it, it's still about Allah. What is it right after you take Alif? Lillah. Meaning, belongs to Allah, right? Lillah. Ma fi samawati wa fi al-ard. Now, you choose to take Alif, the second lam out, right? Then it's still what? Lahu. Ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. You take the third letter, the next lam, and you left with ha, right? And it says Allahu la ilaha illa hu. That hu, it comes from that ha. Every piece of the word the Allah is referred to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the word the Allah. That's the word that Allah loves so much, because every piece of it, inshallah, someday we'll talk, what is the meaning of Allah? Where the word came from? How do you break it down? How did the name came up in Arabic? Right? Allah, it has a meaning. Right? What does it mean? Inshallah, someday we'll talk about it. But here Allah said, Inna Allah, that indeed Allah, which is every being, everyone that Allah ever created in this universe, right? they all are a servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our scholars, they say this word, Allah, is jami'ul asma, combines all the names of Allah, all the attributes. And you go to one of the surah, Allah said about those names that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described himself, هو الرحمن الذي لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون. Right? All of these names, هو الله. That when Allah said, He is Allah. Who is Allah? He said, المتكبر المهيمن العزيز الجبار. All of these, they are all included in just the word Allah. So when he said Allah, meaning you are combining every attribute of Allah in just that word. And that is why when Allah said, Inna Allah, that indeed Allah, right? He said, He, Allah, the first one to mention in the ayah, wa malaikatahu. Malaika, the angels. Angels. Allahu Akbar. And inshallah, tonight I'll tell you, there are two meanings of the word al-malaika. The first meaning of the word malaika, which we know, is the angels, right? Which is another being that Allah created. And those angels, they are the most creatures of Allah, more than anything Allah ever created. Allah didn't create anything as much as angels. They are the most creatures of Allah. And they ask Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He says, what is the number of the angels? Then the Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq say, ka'adad al-turab. Like the number of the sand. Can you count the sand? No. He said, that's how the angels are. That's how many the angels are. And Quran talks about some of them. Oh, let me give you some of the background about them. This is the first tafsir of the malaika, angels. Some of the angels that Allah created, we don't even know who they are and what their numbers are. One of them, for the first angel Allah created, one of them is known as Al-Muhasib, the accountant. You know, we think that only bank has an accountant, right? No, Allah is an accountant too. He counts everything. In the night of Isra and Mi'raj, the Prophet met him. And he was counting everything. And the Prophet asked him, what do you do? He said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm an accountant of Allah. So what do you count? He said, I count everything. Everything is like what? He said, even the number of the drop of the rain, I count. Every rain that comes down, doesn't matter in the east or south, every part of the earth, he said, I know them. How many numbers of the rain comes down? The risk of Allah, who is giving risk, who is not being given, every. I have all the calculation. So good. Then the Prophet asked him another question. Is there anything you cannot count? He said, yes. What is it that you cannot count? Listen careful. He can count everything, but one thing he cannot count. What is it? He said, two things I cannot count. The first one, he said, when the people stand in Jama'ah prayer and the number become from four and up, I don't know the number of the thawab except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is to tell you the importance of Salatul Jama'ah, brothers. That's one. Then the Prophet asked him, what is the next thing that you cannot count? He said, the next thing that I cannot count is the number of the thawab or reward of a person when he or she says the salawat to the Prophet and his descendants. I don't have the knowledge of it. But anything else, I say I know. Right? This is the angel. The first one is called Al-Muhasib, the angel who is accountant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one of them. And just to give you a brief, when you go to Nahjul Balagha, there is a page where Imam Ali described the angels, how they're created and their responsibilities. So many of them. Let me share with you some of them. Some of those angels from this, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he said, وَمِنْهُمْ رُكَّعْ. There are some of them Allah created, they are in the state of ruku and they will stay till the day of judgment. You know, we do ruku, you know, for 5 daily prayers and we complain, right? Think I do a lot. Allah, 5 daily prayers too much. The angels were created from the one that Allah created. They stayed in the state of ruku and they're happy. And Quran says, La yas'amun. They don't get tired from serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is angel number two. And instead of ruku, then there are some women who are sujjad. There are some of them Allah created. They are also in the state of sujood from the one that Allah created them. And they never get tired. That is true. Number four, there are some, they call them also hamalatul arsh. وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ ثَمَانٍ. The fourth angels are the ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them. They are carrying the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the throne of Allah doesn't mean the chair. No, the throne here, it means some of the knowledge of the or the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has given them that power. That is another angels. Some angels, they're called An-Nazi'at. An-Nazi'at are some angels that Allah created. Their job is just to take the life of non-believers. And they call them Nazi'at in Quran. Then there is the opposite of those. They're called An-Nashitat. An-Nashitat are the angels who take the life of mu'mineen. And the leader of that angels is called Malakul Maut. This Malakul Maut is the one that Allah have assigned to be the one taking care of the death. That is some of the angels. Then there's another angel, their job is what? Is to take this one, their job is to take life. There is another angel, their job is to give life. Some take, some give. Some narrations say that angel who gives life is called a ruh. When you read in Surah Al-Qadr, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ. Al-Ruh is the angel, some of the tafsir, they said, is the angel who blows the life in the beings. It's called Al-Ruh. That is one of the angels. Then there are some angels, they call them Hafada. Hafada means protectors. And one of them is in the front, one of them at the back. يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ. We don't see them. Allahu Akbar. You know, these are called secret servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of them is in the front, one of them at the back. Their job is to protect of us. And every human being has them. That is called hafada. There are others also, which Quran called them kiraman katibin. Kiraman katibin, the writers, noble writers. One is on the right and one is on the left. What do? The one on the right is the one writes all the good deeds. And Quran calls him Raqib. Raqib means observer. Nothing happens without him notice. Then there's one on the left is called Atid. Atid is the one who is in charge on the wrong, on the sins. Whenever a person commits sins, he is the one in charge to write it. But then Allah, look at the Allah's mercy. Then Allah made Raqib to be in charge of him. That anytime we commit sin, then the Raqib tells the Atid, don't write it. Wait, maybe he might ask Allah's forgiveness. No. Then you're waiting. Until we commit a next sin, if we don't do istighfar, then Raqib tells Atid, write the previous one and give him the chance the next one. But when you come to the good deeds, right? The moment we even think about the good deeds, not even done it yet. Just thinking about it, then Allah tells Raqib, write it down. When you do the good deeds, then he tells him, okay, write even for one good deed, 10 rewards. Look at the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is called what? Raqib al-Ajib. Some angels now, they Allah created them. Their job is to be in the grave. Right? And where do they they are in their immigration of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you land in that airport, right? You know that airport? You fly. Right? When you fly and you get to the airport, you go through immigration, right? Before they let you in or they deport you. Right? Now, when we die, we fly because we get carried, don't we? Huh? On the shoulders, you're flying, huh? You get to that airport. Where is that airport? That grave, right? You have to go through security. Where is that security? Allahu Akbar. Allah has two security guards, immigration officers. They're waiting there. No. Those immigration officers, they have two names, depending on who you are, right? If a person is a good person, they call those angels Bashir wa Mubashir. If the person is bad, the disease is bad, then they call Munkir wa Nakir. Right? Now, when we go there, those immigration officers, they're already waiting because they know somebody's landing. Right? The same thing at the airport. Right? Immigration officer, before the plane lands, they already know they are there, counter waiting. Right? The moment you walk in, they're going to ask you your passport. Now, those immigration officers also are there. And the Prophet told us in the hadith, it says, أَوَّلُ مَا يُسْأَلُ الْعَبْدُ عَنْهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الصَّلَاةِ. When we get to that immigration, they ask you your passport. But that passport is not the paper passport and the picture that we think of, no. That passport and that immigration is your salat. When you come, or you come, and they ask you your salat, and you said, this is my salat, right? The Prophet told us, it says, and kubilat kubila ma siwaha. If that salat, they look at it, the picture is nice, the name is right, you look at the same person, right? You go through ruku and sujood and qira'ah and everything. If everything is done properly, it's done. And then what did they tell you? Enjoy your stay or welcome home, right? Yes. That's what they tell us here when you travel and you come back in America. But in that immigration, the moment they look at salat, everything is bad, it's good, they also give you stamp and they tell you, enjoy your stay. If there is wrong, something wrong with your salat, you know what did they do? They deport you. What did they deport you to? To the hellfire. Because they are in the heaven. They are not in the hellfire. They are in the heaven. Right? So now you come into heaven. They tell you because your salat was not done properly, they tell you you have to be deported. Where are you going to deport it? You're going to deport it, babe. And to where? To the, what do we call it? Al-Nar. To the hellfire. And they will take care of you from that. These are called Al-Munkar wa Nakir. And in our talqeen, when somebody passed, we mentioned it. إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمَلَكَانَ الْمُقَرَّبَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ وَسَأَلَاكَ أَنْ رَبِّكَ وَعَنْ نَبِيِّكَ وَعَنْ إِمَامِكَ وَعَنْ دِينِكَ وَعَنْ كِتَابِكَ وَعَنْ كِبْلَتِكَ فَلَا تَخَفْ وَقُلْ فِي جَوَابِهِمَا اللَّهُ جَلَّ جَلَالُهُ رَبِّي and so on and so on. You have to give them the answer. They have questions for you. Like here when they come, they ask you, where are you coming from? How long were you out? Right? How long are you staying? They ask you questions. They also ask the questions like that. Now those angels, they are called وَمُنْكِرْ وَنَكِرْ أَوْ بَشِيرْ أُمُبَشِّرْ. Now, these are some of the angels. Now, another angel also Allah created. They are called that one angel and is called Ar-Radwan. Ar-Radwan is the angel who is in charge of the heavens. No person can get to the heaven unless he is aware of him. Every person, he is the one who has to give you permission to enter after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's called Ar-Radwan. Then another one is called the angel who also is in charge of Hisab on the day of judgment, accountability, and is called Malik. And Quran talks about him. وَقَالُوا يَا مَالِكَ لِيَقْضَ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكَ قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. On the day of judgment, we'll go to him, asking him to talk to Allah, for Allah to account us, and he tells us, no, it's not time yet, keep standing. That angel is called Malik. There is that angel. Then there's another angel who is the leader of all of those angels, and his name is Jibreel. Jibreel is the boss. And Quran talks about him in the Quran that Allah said, he is the one who is obeyed by every angel. And Allah talks about him, ذِي قُوَّةٍ عِنْدَ ذِي الْعَرْشِ مكين مطاع ثم عميل. مطاع, obey. No angel can go against the will of Jibreel. And that Jibreel, his job is to message, give the message to the prophet. Then there are other angels also, their job is, they are reserved. They are reserved. It means what? They are army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they are reserved, waiting anytime Allah wants them. And then they go and fight for the sake of Allah. And you can see in the battle of Badr, Allah talks about them. وَأَنزَلَ جُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا. We send the armies you cannot see. That the number of the Muslims on the Battle of Badr was not, they're not that much, right? But the Muslims were able to win that battle because of the armies which are reserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those reserved were angels. It's a call, according to the Quran, Junud Lam Tara, secret servants. You can see them, but they're working. Right? Then another angel is called Mikael. What does Mikael do? Mikael is one of the angels. His job is to take care of the rizq. Who gets what? Who gets what? That is his job. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assigned him on that. But he doesn't give without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another angel Allah also created, that angel, what is his job? His job also is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the assignment of blowing the trumpet. You know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want the world to come to an end. وَنُفَإِذَا جَاءَ فَإِذَا نُفِقَ فِي السُّورِ فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. His job is twice. That's it. The first one is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him to blow the horn on the day that the world will come to an end. That is the first one. And then the second one is when the Qiyamah is about to start. That is his job. That is another angel Allah created. And so on and so forth. All of these angels were different responsibilities, right? But then Allah told us, even though they have all different responsibility, but they all have one thing in common also. Common responsibility. What is it? They all in combined are also saying salawat to Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. And that's what Allah said, Inna Allah wa malaikatahu, right? But now understand something here, brothers and sisters. You know, malaika, the first tafsir is Allah is talking about the angels, because that's one of the tafsir. But there's another tafsir of the word malaika, which is from Imam Baqir alayhi salam. Where he says, Al-Malaika does not mean angels. What does he mean? He said the word Malaika comes from the word Malak. Malak means ability and the power. Right? Al-Malaika, we call them Malaika because they have ability to do things. Now they said, Al-Malaika means ability. And the Imam said the word Al-Malaika does not mean angel. Malaika means every being which has a power to do something is called Malaika. And then Imam has a beautiful, what do you call, answer to this. Where he said, why do you think when Allah said to the angels when he created Adam, he says, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمْ. Right? Allah said, Malaika. If the word Malaika means angel, Allah wouldn't have kicked Shaitan out of the heaven. Because Allah said, Malaika. If Malaika means angel, and Shaitan was not an angel, why would Allah punish him when he referred to the angels as Malaika? But Allah said, Malaika, because he didn't mean angel. He means every being which has the ability of sajda should do the sajda. And that's what the meaning of Malaika is. Now, if we are to go with the tafsir of Imam Baqir, Malaika means an angels, one. Malaika means humans, two. Malaika means animals, three. Malaika means the heavens and the earth, meaning every being that ever existed, Allah is inviting them to do salawat to Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. So then the third one, because he had the three things Allah invited for salawat. The first one is himself, the second one is the angels, and the third one is Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. Allahu Akbar. Here is amazing, different. The first one is Allah, right? Allah, that's it. The second one is angels or the other creatures. But when Allah came to humans, Allah didn't call all humans, no. Because salawat is a pure ibadah and it requires pure people. Not everybody. Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina aman, not Ya ayyuhal nas. Ya ayyuhal nas means every human being is required to do salawat. No, but Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina aman means it's a specific group of people who are pure and clean like Allah and the angels, who is clean like Allah and the angels who are pure. Allah said, those pure group, Allah, with the leadership of Allah and the angels, Allah said, the three of us and combine, come and do something for Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. What is it? It said, Yusalluna ala nabi. It said, continuously we send in our salutation to whom? To Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. Then Allah said, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Now question. There are three salawat here. One is Allah, because Allah said, Inna Allah, Allah does salawat. The second one is the angels. The third one is people. Now what is the different salawat? Is it all one salawat or two different salawat or three salawat? Here our tafsir says, salawat of Allah is different than the salawat of the angels or the other creatures. Or the salawat of the angels also is different than our salawat. Now, what is the salawat of Allah? When Allah said, Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusallun. Allah said, I'm doing salawat. What is the salawat of Allah? They said, salawat of Allah is a tanzih, means to increase, to purify Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. That's the salawat. That is the salawat of Allah. So when you hear Allah said the salawat is continuously to purify them, because Allah said in another ayah, Surah Al-Ahzab, Innama yuridu Allah liyudhhiba ankum ar-rijsa ahlal bayt wa yutahhirakum. Purifies. That's what Allah does. Yurid. Allah does. So salawat of Allah to continuously purify Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. That's the salawat of Allah.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Now, what's the salawat of the angels and other beings? They said, the salawat of the angels and the other creatures, they said, talab nuzul ar-rahmati ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. They continuously asking Allah to send the rahmah of Prophet, the rahmah of Allah upon the Prophet. Like Allah said in the Quran, Inna arsalna wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen. They want Allah to increase the rahmah of the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt. That is the second one. Now, our salawat, what does it mean as a human? The mu'mineen. They says, our salawat is talab rafa'i daraja. Allah to elevate the position of the Prophet and take him higher and higher. And that is why in namaz we say, wa taqabbal shafa'atahu fi ummatihi warfa' daraja. Rafa'i daraja. Allah, raise him higher, because whenever you raise him higher, we have more opportunity of shafa'ah. That's what we, our salawat is. So whenever we say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala, our salawat, it means we want Allah to elevate his positions higher and higher. Now, what is the salawat and how do we say? When this ayah was revealed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, Ya Rasulallah, kayfa nusalli alayk? How should we say salawat to you? Then the Prophet said, La tusallu alayya salat al-batra. Do not send salawat to me, which is short salawat. You say, what is the short salawat? He say, antaqulu. You say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa tasmutu. You say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, and be quiet. Like we hear some of the Muslims say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa sallim. Right? He said, what should we say? How should we say it? He said, walakin kul. The proper one, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. That is the full salawat upon Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Man salla alayya salatan, Allahu Akbar. Whoever sent one salawat, Allahumma salli ala, one time, right? He said, Sallaytu alayhi bi ashar. One salawat you sent to the Prophet, he said, in return, I'll say 10 for you. وَمَنْ صَلَّى عَلَيَّ عَشَرًا Whoever sent 10 salawat upon me, he said, صَلَّيْتُ عَلَيْهِ مِعَ You send one 10 salawat, the Prophet said, I'll send 100 for you. وَمَنْ صَلَّى عَلَيَّ مِعَ Whoever sent salawat 100 times on me, he said, صَلَّيْتُ عَلَيْهِ بِأَلْفِ I said, then I will respond with salawat for him 1,000 times. وَمَنْ صَلَّى عَلَيَّ بِأَلْفِ Whoever sends salawat to me, 1,000. He says, Sallaytu alayhi salatan la ya'arifu adadahu illallah. 1,000 salawat. The Prophet said, then I will say salawat for you. And the way that nobody can tell how much and the number of it, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
That is the benefit of salawat. Another one, brothers. You know salawat. The Prophet says in Hadith, "Man lam yajid ma yukaffiru bihi dhunuba, falyukaffir bis-salat ala Muhammad wa ali." Whenever you commit, a person commits sins, and they have to pay kafara. Kafara means a punishment, right? The Prophet said, "If you cannot find anything to pay for it, I'm too poor. I cannot find anything to pay. What can I do?" Then the Prophet says, "Falyukaffir bis-salat ala Muhammad wa ali." The last thing you can do is to send the salawat to Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. And that takes care of your kafara. That is one of the benefits of kafara, a salawat. Another one. Also, this is for Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
What he said, if a person ever wants Allah to ask to accept his dua, right? You want Allah to accept your dua? He said, never ever start your dua without sending salawat. Why? He says, because your dua without salawat, it has maybe accepted or might not be accepted. But when your dua comes with salawat, Allah feels shy to accept salawat and reject your dua. Then for the sake of salawat, Allah accepts your dua. Now there is even better trick from Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. They say, put your dua between two salawats. One in the beginning, one at the end. You start with salawat and end with salawat. They say, Allah cannot reject the first salawat, nor the last salawat. And to go from the first to the second and not take something in between, they say, Allah feels shy to do so for you. So for the sake of these two salawat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your dua, which is between the first and the end of salah. That is one of the benefits of salah. Another one, brothers. You know, one of the diseases of the heart, one of the diseases of the heart, if you want to eliminate it, what should you do? The Prophet said, أكثروا من الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد فإنها تذهب النفاق. The person has some kind of like hypocrisy, nifaq, munafiq, right? I want to eliminate that disease. What can I do? The Prophet says, he said, say a lot of salawat, because one of the things that can eliminate and purify your heart is the salawat upon Muhammad and Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Not only that, the Prophet tells us about the salawat also. He says, salawat is so important to the part If a person does his salat, any salat, Fajr, Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and you fail to say salat, and that salat, what happened to your salat? It's batil. This is from one of the scholars, Al-Shafi'i. Ya Ahl Bayt al-Nubuwa, kafakum min azim al-sha'an. In one of the narration, azim al-qadr, annahu man lam yusalli alaykum, la salata lahu. Is Imam al-Shafi'i says, I say, Ya Ahl al-Bayt, it's sufficient for you to know how Allah has praised you to the point in salat. If somebody doesn't say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, I say, that salat is batil. That salat is so important that even in your salat, in your 5 daily prayers, if we fail to say it, our salat is batil. That is the importance of salat. Now, who are the Muhammad and Ali Muhammad? One of those Ali Muhammad is Zahra al-Batul alayhi salam.
Allahumma salli Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
That Fatima alayhi salam, which the Prophet talks about her, is Fatima to Bada'atu minni. Fatima is part of me. Man ahabbaha faqad ahabbani. And amazing, amazing. When you go to the ayah we just read in Surah Al-Ahzab, right after Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi, the next ayah, Inna alladhina yu'dhuna Allah wa rasula la'anahumullah. Those who hurt in Allah and the Prophet, Allah said, we curse them in Surah Al-Ahzab. Right? Now listen carefully. The Prophet says, Fatima tabadatu minni. Man ahabbaha, faqad ahabbani. Wa man aadhaha. He who hurts her, faqad aadhani. Wa man aadhani, faqad aadhallah. Who hurts me, hurts Allah. You hurt Zahra, you hurt the Prophet. You hurt the Prophet, you hurt Allah. And whoever hurts Allah, أَكَبَّهُ اللَّهُ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ. Allah said, I throw him in the hellfire of Jahannam. The Prophet, every narration that you can find, they all agree that the Prophet loved Fatima Zahra. حُبًّا شَدِيدًا. So much. To the point where the Prophet, the night of his death, the Prophet was in his deathbed, and Zahra was sitting next to him. And she was looking at their father, the most greatest person Allah ever had created on this planet. And then he said to her, Ya Zahra, La karba ala abiki ba'da al-yawm. Today is your last surah of your father. If you ever see your father to be sad about something, this is the last time. Then Zahra came close and said, Ya Abba, what does it mean? He said, In sah fa inna abak, your father is departing from this world. Zahra alayhi salam, she bursted into tears. Because where can you find a father like Rasulullah? The most caring, the most loving, the most compassionate man on the planet is Rasulullah. Then Zahra alayhi salam, she bursted into tears and cried. Then the Prophet called her again. Ya Zahra, come closer. Then the Prophet said something in her ear, and she started smiling. Ya Rasulullah, what did you tell your daughter? What is it? Zahra was suddenly started smiling. Imam Ali asked Zahra, why are you smiling? You were crying. She said, yes, the Prophet told me something. What was it? Say, Ya Zahra, anti sari'atul lihaqbi. You are the one that quickly will meet me in Barzakh. You are the next one to die among my family. How soon, Ya Rasulullah? 6 months later. 6 months? The Prophet was in this situation. And the Prophet passed. The Prophet was in his room before the body was washed. Zahra was at home, crying, losing her father. People came, they attacked that house and broke the house. That house where Rasulullah, wherever he comes, he knocks the door and waits. Zahra will tell him, Ya Rasulallah, al-baytu baytuk, wal-karimatu karimatuk, udkhul. Ya Rasulallah, the house is your house, and the door is your door, you don't need the permission. And then Rasulullah will say, Ya Zahra, inna Allah amarani bidhal. Ya Zahra, Allah told me not to enter your house without asking your permission first. Jabra'il, before when he came down, in Hadith al-Kisa, he said, Ya Rasulallah, ata'adhanu li an adkhulaha? Tahta al-Kisa. He's asking permission, Ya Rasulallah. Allah already gave me permission. He came down, but he said, I'm not going to go inside until Allah, the Prophet give me permission. He asked the permission. Ata'adhanu li an adkhula ma'akum, fa'akuna ma'akum sadisan, so it can be the sixth one. Under that Kisa, right? This is Jabra'il with the permission, but he doesn't enter the house of Zahra without the permission of the Prophet. These people came to the house of Zahra, and then they told him, in Tariq al-Tabari quote, he said, one of them said, "Inna fiha Zahra, inna fil bayt Fatima, in the house that is Fatima." And then the man said, "Wa in, so what if Zahra is in there?" Zahra alayhi salam, she was in the house. When they came to the house, they broke into the house when Zahra was standing behind the door. What a hijab. When they attacked the house, Zahra then called Asma. Ya Asma, come to my aid. Ya Asma, asnidini. Zahra couldn't stand anymore. Why? The narration says, because kana hunaka al-mismarun wara al-bab. There was a nail behind that door, which went direct to the backbone of Zahra alayhi salam, which broke the backbone of Zahra, which she couldn't stand anymore. And she asked, Yasma, I want you to please help me to stand. Zahra alayhi salam could not live after this incident. The narration in the history, they said, after that incident, the next day, Zahra alayhi salam was in a bed. The women of Medina, they came to visit her. And then they ask her, Ya Fatima, kayfa asbahti? How are you? How are you feeling, Ya Zahra? She said, Wallahi asbahtu a'ifatu rilijalikun. I am not happy with your man who came to my house and broke that house. The house where Rasulullah, every single morning after the ayat of Tathir was revealed, the Prophet will come and knock the door and he said, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ أَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. That house was the house that was attacked. After Zahra alayhi salam, not only she had that broken bone, Zahra alayhi salam, she was pregnant with a baby that Rasulullah named Muhsin before he was born. Zahra alayhi salam lost that baby as well. The narration said, Zahra alayhi salam, after that tragedy, she will go to the grave of the Prophet and cry, and she said, Mada ala man shamma turab Muhammad. Because she used to cry in the house, and some of the companions, they complain. They say, why Zahra is bothering us with all the cries all the time? Allahu Akbar. And she mentioned the reason why she cries so much. And she said, Subbat alayya masa'ibun, law annaha subbat ala al-ayyam lasirna layaliya. I said, I have been afflicted with the tragedies, that those tragedies, if they are to be put on the days would have turned night. Allahu Akbar. Ya Zahra, this is the door of the Prophet. The Prophet died, and the Muslims cannot take care of the door of the Prophet. Zahra alayhi salam, she will go to the grave of the Prophet and cry all night. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, are you watching at your daughter and those tragedy that she's going through? Allahu Akbar. Imam Ali alayhi salam, every day he looks at the daughter of the Prophet and he knows what is bothering her because of what they have treated the Prophet, the daughter of the Prophet. But the worst part, brothers and sisters, when Zahra alayhi salam before her martyrdom, she told Imam Ali alayhi salam, Ya Ali, إِذَا مِتُّ فَدُفُنِّي لَيْلًا. I said, when I die, I want to be buried at night. Ya Zahra, you are the daughter of the Prophet. Ya Zahra, your father is Rasulullah. It should be announced when all mu'minin come. to take a pride in your janazah. But Zahra said, no, I want to be buried at night, lonely, so that can give the message to the Muslim to know how I was oppressed after my father, Rasulullah. And she said to Imam Ali, Ya Ali, wala wa'abbi mawdha kabri. Ya Ali, don't let anybody know my grave. Allahu Akbar, brothers and sisters, who is Zahra today, you and I? We know those people who have served our countries. They have graves. We go and put flowers and remember them every year. Zahra was the one who sacrificed for Islam and the Prophet during his lifetime. And now we don't even know the grave of Zahra to put a flower or read Fatiha for her grave. What a shame on Muslims today, brothers and sisters. You go back to the history, the narration said in Lebanon, when Prophet Isa alayhi salam was on his camel traveling and there was a footprint of a camel, the Christians, they took that footprint and built on that place to be a church just because there is a footprint of the camel of Prophet Isa. And Zahra is not just the footprint, it's the daughter of Rasulullah. That after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, we're supposed to take care of Zahra and honor her and cherish her because she is part of Rasulullah. But no, 6 months later, she left this world without nobody noticing where the grave of Zahra is. And the Zahra told Imam Ali, Ya Ali, I said, Wala yara mawdha akabri illa bnai al-Hasan wal-Husayn. I don't want anybody to follow my coffin, other than my son, Imam Hassan and Hussein, and Asma at that set. And there was only 4 people in janazah of Zahra alayhi salam. Who is Zahra, the daughter of the Prophet, who served Islam and served through Prophet. But now she has only 4 people to come to her burial. And nobody knows where she was. And the night of Shahada, she told Asma after she woke up in the morning, she tried to bathe Hassan and Hussein and told them to go to the masjid with their father, Imam Ali. And she told Asma, Ya Asma, Ana aqra al-Quran. I want to read Quran, but I'll be in my room alone. Ya Asma, if you heard the silence, that means I'm gone from this world. The narration said, Asma said, I was in the house. I was hearing the voice of Zahra reading Quran. Until I started to hear the voice was fading little by little, until I heard the silence, completely silent. She said, I rushed to the room and I saw Zahra alayhi salam. She was already dead. I was looking at her. فَإِذَا دَخَلَ الْحَسَنُ وَالْحُسَيْنَ. And Hassan and Hussein entered. Now look at the tragedy here, brothers and sisters. Al-Hassan and Hussein, when they entered the house, Imam Hussein asked Asma, أَيْنَ أُمُّنَ الزَّهْرَى. Where is our mother? Asma said, I got confused. What should I say? Should I say she is sleeping or she is dead? I said, I can't tell them their mother has passed because they cannot handle it. She said, let me tell them that he is sleeping. Then she told Imam Hussein, "Inna ummuki na'im." Your mother is sleeping. Then Imam Hussein said, Ya Asma, ma kana ummuna tanam fi hadha al-sa'a. This is not the time our mother normally sleep. Where is she? She said, while I was looking at them, I didn't know what to do. Imam Hussein and Hassan, they rushed to the room and they saw their mother was laying. She said, then Imam Hussein down for his body, on the body of Zahra alayhi salam. And he called her, Ya Umma, kallimini. My mother, please speak to me. The 3 times Zahra did not answer. Imam Hussein alayhi salam then said the 3rd time, Ya Umma, kallimini qabla an yufariqa ruhi min badani. Talk to me before my spirit leaves my body. Asma said, I was watching the scene. Wallahi, I could see like Zahra wanted to hug Hussein alayhi salam. But I was standing there, I didn't know what to do. Then I rushed to the masjid. I got to the masjid, Imam Ali was sitting there. Before I talked to him, he said, I heard what is happening. She, Imam Ali alayhi salam, rushed to the house. And he said, Wallah, I heard a call from Jibreel. Say, Ya Jibreel, the angels in the heaven, they cannot stand the scene of Hussein and his mother Zahra alayhi salam. ارفع الحسين عن الزهراء. Go and lift Hussein on Zahra alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. Imam Hussein came and he saw Al-Hassan and Hussein. They both on their mother crying for losing for such a mother, Al-Zahra alayhi salam. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he came and picked Hussein alayhi salam from his mother. He picked Hassan alayhi salam. And they both was there. Mama ummuna la tukallimuna. Why our mother doesn't say a word to us today? She used to always call us, ya qurrata aini, ya thamarata fuadi. But today she hadn't said a word. Imam Ali alayhi salam sat next to Zahra alayhi salam and busted into tears for the tragedy. And he called, ya Rasulallah, where are you to see a day like today? Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ayyamun qalabin yanqalibun. وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Ya Allah, we ask you for the sake of Zahra, al-madlouma, ya Allah, we ask you. Ya Allah, all the madloumin in this universe, every part of the earth, ya Allah, freedom for the sake of the oppression that Zahra went through, ya Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah, we ask you, brothers and sisters who are sick for the sake of madlouma Zahra, ya Allah, give them the fastest recovery, ya Rabbil Alameen. Our marhumeen, brothers and sisters, ya Allah, have your mercy upon them for the sake of Zahra alayhi salam. Ya Allah, on the day of judgment, let us be among those who will earn the shafa of Zahra alayhi salam. Ila amwatikum wa amwat al-mu'mineen wa al-mu'minat. Rahmallahu man kara al-fatihata ma'as salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Bismillah. Alhamdulillah.